Hi, my name is Swati. I have been with you for a few lectures now, and we kind of are seeing a repeat in my pattern. I love to talk about emotions. And taking on emotions again, a couple of healthy practices can end up helping us to be able to live a much more richer life in our mind and our soul as well. If our mind and soul are feeling that sense of health, automatically the body also begins to feel a sense of health. So one of the most important and the most prominent one that we need to look at is introspection. Introspection is a very, very, very important practice. Now, introspection, unfortunately, can be a very complex practice. What we mean here is, agar I am trying to introspect, I introspect with my own limitations of how much I understand the psychological way of thinking. So I can give myself a reason saying, I am angry because you are making me angry. Or I can accept and I say, I'm a short-tempered person. But that is not introspection. Introspection is a permission to go a lot more deeper. Now, how do we go a lot more deeper? Aap agar dekhenge, all of us have random thoughts. The mind is never quiet to come back and say that you have zero thoughts the whole day. Ek bhi thought nahi aaya. Ab ye jo random thoughts hote hain, they a lot of times become very important for the element of introspection. So giving oneself explanation or reasoning is not introspection, that is limited by the mind. But when we begin to pick on random thoughts, then introspection is facilitated. In a good mood, you're going to be having more or less positive thoughts. You will feel that koi bhi project aapko karna hai, you'll be able to crack it, things will work out for you. In a bad mood, you will end up feeling that things are not working out for you. So thoughts will be more of failures and confusions or things like that. There are days you'll have thoughts ki people are supporting you. There are days you'll have thought ki the whole world is against you. So given that there are different kinds of thoughts, thoughts can be a window to the emotion that we are feeling at that point of time. Right? So we have to learn to take both thinking and feeling along when we are looking at introspection. A lot of us make a mistake. We look at only the rationalization part of it and we call it introspection. Now, if we take simple things, how does introspection begin? Introspection begins very much in the childhood. How? A child is throwing a tantrum. Now, when the child is throwing a tantrum, instead of scolding the child, if at all there is a facilitation to, oh, you seem to be in a bad mood, are you hungry or is there something happening? Child doesn't understand. The child will not be able to answer you. But the fact that you facilitated the thinking, it is almost like learning ABCD to be able to learn a language later on. Similarly, being able to ask yourself simple questions is how introspection ends up beginning as a practice. Right? Now here, one thing that we end up thinking as counselors is, no thought or emotion is independent in itself. All of it is like a recipe. Aap agar koi basic sabji bhi bana rahe hai, suppose aap aloo ka sabji bana rahe, does only aloo be a part of it? No. You will have the oil and the rye and the salt and the haldi and things like that. So whenever you are introspecting, what is very important to understand, don't hold that one reason for why you are thinking something or why you are feeling something. If you stop yourself from thinking or feeling that one thing, and that will then end up becoming an excuse or an explanation you are giving yourself. We call it rationalization. Okay. So, introspection requires us to keep asking us a question, why. I'll take a small example and we'll lead with it. Suppose we take a name saying Rahul. Rahul is angry. Why is Rahul angry? Because he had a fight with a friend. Why did he have a fight with a friend? Because they had a difference of opinion. What is the difference of opinion they ended up having? He thought that the friend was being rude and the friend thought that he was being assertive. why did they end up having that difference of opinion? Because the way Rahul heard it was a little different. Why did Rahul hear it a little differently? Because he cannot handle people talking in a particular tone. Why does Rahul get affected by a particular tone? Because his father used to scold him in that particular tone. Why would his father scold him in that particular tone? Because the father could not get across to Rahul in any other tone, or the father did not make time to be able to speak. So there are certain tones jo kisi ko affect kar jati hai, kisi ko nahi karti hai. So instead of waiting immediately at saying you spoke the bad tone and that's why I got affected, introspection means I ask myself, why did I get affected? That was a bad tone. I told the person we can speak about it in another way. I don't need to get offended. So if an emotion has gotten aroused in me, means there is something to that particular thing. Okay. And very important to understand is, a lot of times people make this mistake to try to find one problem. There is never going to be one problem. So if anybody is scared of closed places, we try to find out kabhi kisi jagah band ho gaye the kya, lift mein atak gaye the kya. No, it is not because of one reason. When you feel you can't open up and express, you end up feeling that you're choking from inside. And that's over a period of time. Any one incident cannot create that kind of trauma, which can then, you know, stop us from or develop a pathology. Pathologies don't happen because of one incident. I mean, I'm talking about grave things like a family member has committed suicide, or a rape has ended up happening, child sexual abuse. There are a lot of bad things that end up happening. But that one thing, if healed, will not cause pathology in any form. So introspection means I ask myself the question of why, till I'm able to find a deeper thing. Initially, introspection might not be helped only by doing it myself. What happens with self-analysis? I am defensive about my own weaknesses. So I will give myself one very nice explanation as to why I'm feeling that way. Okay? I cannot talk to a friend about it. The reason being, the friend will have his own opinion about me, and that opinion then will end up saying, "Haan, tu to hamesha hi kaisa karta hai, tu to bahut na short-tempered ya moody hai." Now that's not introspection. To call myself short-tempered and moody is not a diagnosis, is not the problem for me to be reaching a breakthrough. So to be able to introspect is a learning journey. We do it with people who are at least 15 years or 10-15 years older to us. They have been there. They have seen that. They have outgrown it. They have lived that particular experience. Now, because they have outgrown that particular experience, they might be able to tell you simply in wise words, saying, "Beta, kabhi kabhi gusse mein bolte hain, jaane do. Iske bare mein zyada mat socho." Kabhi kabhi they can come back and tell you, "Beta, usne kyun kiya, pata to karo." The person reacted badly, but try to figure out a little more. So somebody who has experienced life will be able to facilitate introspection. So when we begin to learn introspection, it is better to start it with somebody who has experienced life a little more than us. So one very important emotional habit is to be able to introspect. Many people do it with writing a diary. So when they are rereading their thoughts, they are able to see a pattern. Many people do it by talking to somebody. Many people do it with the sense of meditation, where you permit yourself to read your own thoughts and figure out that. So counseling is the only way of introspection. I will never encourage people to say counseling is the only way of introspection. It's just one another way. The counselor takes you through a journey of introspection. The counselor has no advices to give you. A lot of times we mistake the profession that way. Okay, we all have our own answers. We are all brought up in different cultures and environments. So what might work as an answer for me might not work as an answer for somebody else. So for example, if I come from a liberal family background and being assertive as a woman is very easy, that might not be the same case with the client that I'm working with, she might not be feeling that independent, that I come back and tell her, become a very assertive woman. In fact, she will then have more problems till the time she doesn't end up standing on her own feet. But within her world, her solutions is something she can figure out. And for the solutions, introspection is important. So introspection is one healthy habit we are looking at. The other healthy emotional attitude we need to have is what we call empathy. Simply defining empathy as the ability to be able to receive the other person's emotions as it is. A lot of times, to make it easy, we end up saying, put your shoes in another person's shoes, you will understand. वहाँ थोड़ा limitation आता है. Suppose मेरा जूता सामने वाले का जूते का size बड़ा है और मेरा पाँव छोटा है. I'll not have a problem in that shoes. Okay. So it simply means that receive that emotion. A lot of us find it very difficult to do something when somebody is crying. So is there something to be done when somebody is crying? I don't think so. You can maximum offer a glass of water and sit there beside them. If you're more of a touchy person, you can hold the hand. As counselors, we are recommended not to interfere in their space at all. So we just sit there having offered that glass of water and say nothing. Now, empathy simply means not trying to correct what is happening, just able to receive what is going on in that world. A student of mine had narrated this story. I found it very beautiful and it's a wonderful empathy story. There's a child, 10, 12 year old child. She usually comes back home on time. One day, she came back home much later than her scheduled time. So the mother asked her, beta, aap late kyun ho gaye? आप तो हमेशा टाइम पे आ जाते हो. सो द चाइल्ड सेज, मेरी फ्रेंड की डॉल टूट गई थी ना. सो द मदर आज, सो वर यू हेल्पिंग हर फिक्स इट? शी सेड, नो, आई वॉज हेल्पिंग हर क्राई. सो लॉट ऑफ टाइम्स व्हेन यू आर क्राइंग, ऑल्सो व्हेन द अदर पर्सन इज क्राइंग, इज एब्सोल्यूटली ओके. यू डोंट नीड टू चेंज द अदर पर्सन्स वे ऑफ थिंकिंग. व्हेन इन एन इमोशनल स्टेट, यू स्टे इन दैट इमोशनल स्टेट, दैट इज कॉल्ड एम्पैथी. Suppose you're talking about somebody who's very angry. You don't need to feel the anger they are feeling. You could just say, yeah, you seem to be angry. Maybe I'm not understanding the reasons. But it's okay, you're angry. We'll wait for it to pass. Instead of saying it's wrong to be angry. Sadness. A lot of us can't deal with sadness. And that is why we keep pushing ourselves also and others also. Saying, get out of this mood, get out of this mood. So, if there is sadness because of a particular reason or something has happened, it's okay to be in that state of sadness. Happiness, confusion, loyalty, chaos, any emotion expects or commands respect. No emotion needs to be come down and said that is wrong. Okay? But it should pass. That I understand, that you should not hold on to an emotion and sit. But if somebody is feeling a particular kind of an emotion, empathy simply means you permit the other person to feel that emotion till the time the cycle of that emotion is not over. Let's take a small example of recovering from trauma. Okay? Suppose somebody's family member has committed suicide. Now that's a very huge traumatic thing that you can go through. तो नेचुरल डेथ होता है, इट्स द ईजिएस्ट टू बी ओके विद. एक्सीडेंट होता है, इट इज मच वर्सर देन अ नेचुरल डेथ, बट इट इज स्टिल ओके. इफ समबडी गेट्स मर्डर्ड, इट इज वर्सर देन एन एक्सीडेंट बिकॉज क्वेश्चंस बिकम टू मेनी. बट व्हेन समबडी इन योर फैमिली हैज कमिटेड सुसाइड, दैट बिकम्स द वर्स्ट बिकॉज यू डोंट नो वेदर टू सेल्फ ब्लेम. यू डोंट हैव आंसर्स. You don't know whether to blame somebody else. You want to at times say that thing is responsible. You want to at times say, I read the signs. Oh my God, I did not do anything about it. Now, when a person is going through a trauma of that kind, does it make sense telling that person everything is going to be okay? You don't know that. So empathy does not mean sympathy. sympathy is not a healthy, it's a part of human life, but it is not a healthy emotional practice. Empathy is. To be able to say, I don't know what you're going through right now, or I understand what you're going through right now, just hang in there, I'm sure it will pass. Or I can hold you through. If you want to talk, if you want to cry, just know I'm available. The only hope we end up giving to a person who's going through that, yeah, a process we end up giving to a person who's going through that kind of a loss is, culture has told us ki koi bhi death mein se recover hone ko grieving period about 1 year hota hai. So they tell us, don't go in for festivals, don't go for special functions or whatever. Permit yourself to miss that person. Okay. So 13 days there are rituals where you have the relatives and friends come in so you don't feel alone. After that you have certain prayers that end up happening, but you are alone to deal with them then. And for 1 year you are told that take it easy. Don't try to distract yourself and pull yourself out of and forget that person and be in a good mood or things like that. Permit yourself to miss that person. Over a period of a year, that emotion begins to settle. Don't expect it to settle in a month. Now, why I'm talking about empathy so much is because a lot of times when somebody is dealing with their emotion in our presence, we become so restless that we want to fix it. We want to change it. We want to tell them, don't think about it. Chalo, I'll take you out for a party. Aray, a party is a disrespect to the death of the person that ended up happening. So, distraction as a way to deal with pain might not be one of the healthiest practices that we are looking at. Okay. So, the emotional health will come about the more we are going to be able to connect with other people's emotions. Just sharing a slightly personal journey thing. I have made a lot of mistakes myself in my marriage, with my children, with everything, like every other person. But I think my journey still became slightly easier when I look at a lot of people around me because of my profession. When somebody else failed and they were talking to me and I was brainstorming solutions with them, that solution automatically became a part of my solution too. So I didn't have to go alag se and research, mere shaadi mein ye problem chal raha hai, what should I go and do? I would have had 4 husbands come and crib about something and I know, oh, my husband is feeling like that. Okay. So this element of being able to receive somebody else's emotions will enrich us from within because it brings me to the next emotional healthy habit. We call it containment. Problems have to be fixed or solved. Emotions don't. Emotion is just that catalyst which comes with the thought or the action or the life situation. Emotion is not a problem. Even if you are sad, the emotion is not a problem. When do you call something clinical depression? Not because you're feeling sad, just because the neurotransmitters in your mind have begun to not cooperate. That's when you would want medication to be able to solve that. But if I'm having a normal depression because of whatever reason, I'm going through a low, something is happening in my career, I'm not able to achieve as much as I'm thinking and I feel I'll not be able to do it. If I'm going through that feeling for a month or a year, it's not big a deal. Something, somewhere an opportunity will knock and I will bring myself back to that. But the mistake to come back and say, think positive, change your thinking, everything needs to change. I'm a big believer of positive thinking. But lying to yourself is not positive thinking. From within, you're feeling broken. But outside, we are affirming to ourselves, saying everything is okay, everything is okay, everything is okay. So that, where is the thing when I need to move from negative thinking to positive thinking? Where is the thing where I am moving from the truth that I'm feeling within to begin to lie to myself? There's a very thin line between the two things. And that is why a emotional habit called containment is what comes to our rescue. कंटेनमेंट का मतलब क्या होता है, सपोज मुझे बहुत गुस्सा आ रहा है, आई जस्ट परमिट माई सेल्फ टू होल्ड दैट एंगर एंड आस्क माई सेल्फ वॉट एम आई एंग्री अबाउट, इंस्टेड ऑफ गिविंग माई सेल्फ रीजन्स. गुस्सा आ रहा है बिकॉज द वर्ल्ड इज अ बैड प्लेस, बिकॉज द गवर्नमेंट डिड दिस, बिकॉज बीएमसी डिड नॉट टेक केयर, द ब्रिज फेल डाउन. Okay, so a lot of times we end up giving us reasons for anger which might not even be the true reasons. Why are they not the true reasons? I'm not happy feeling angry, so I'll keep trying to find reasons to be angry. In that, I will never find out the real reason to be angry, because my mind will close myself to finding out my problems. It will say the anger is initiated by the outside world. Okay, so if I'm going to hold an emotion long enough, I will be able to come back and say, yes, I am at a reasonable place to say ki I am having anger because of ABCDE. Let me take an easier emotion for that. When young children fall in love with each other, teenagers, and you know, sabko pyar jaldi ho jata hai. Okay, what do adults usually tell the children? Hold on to the relationship. If another 2-3 years you feel the same way about the person, then take the next step. Don't jump into the relationship just because you had a first sight love and now you want to be in love. So what are we saying? Contain that feeling you're having for the other person. If it survives a period of time, then you know it is real and then act on it. Okay, so containment simply means to be able to permit or experience yourself to go through that emotion through many, many layers of your own psyche to then go ahead and act on it. That will bring us to reacting to a situation versus responsibility towards a particular situation, responding to a situation. So containment is the next element we are talking to, which brings me to responsibility. A lot of us mistake blame and responsibility. If I came late today, I am responsible. Okay? No, the traffic was responsible. No, that was responsible. No, the rain was responsible. Okay? A lot of times we end up feeling when I'm saying I am responsible means I have to take the blame of something having gone wrong. But if you pick up the word in itself, it says your ability to respond. I am late. I make a call and say I'm going to be running so very late. Does it suit you or do we need to reschedule? My ability to do something about it or respond to that situation rather than say, oh my God, I am late because of the traffic. I got up late. So self-blame mein jaane ki zarurat nahi hai. Traffic ko bhi blame karne ki zarurat nahi hai. What are you going to do about that particular thing? So a feeling of responsibility, a lot of us mix it up with a sense of duty. Duty is what happens because of your ideology. If you believe you're going to protect the country, you go ahead and become a soldier. That comes from a sense of duty. Okay, that is an ideological state. But responsibility is a feeling state. I become anxious and break down. Or I'm able to look at the situation, permit myself a small breakdown, but then say, what can I do about it? Or do I need to do something about it? Okay. Simple things. Accident on the road. You have to make a decision at that point of time whether you're going to do something about it or not. Okay. Kai baar ye hota hai, if you see many people standing, you choose to not become part of the crowd. And you will move away. Not because you don't care. It is simply because there are just enough hands to help there. But if you have seen an accident, a lot of times responsibility does not mean get desperate, pick up the child person and take them to the hospital. Responsibility means you see how bad the damage is. The way you will carry the person can end up causing more damage. So do you need to initiate that call to an ambulance or do you need to rush the person to the hospital yourself? Taking responsibility means taking that split moment decision to do or not to do. So getting desperate and saying I want to help the world is not being responsible. Getting desperate, I will change the whole world. Nowadays everybody does not want to stop short of changing the world. Everybody is trying to change the world. Towards what? Which way? Now certain people have visions, like Health Library has a vision. We are going to be catering to the health sector and we create awareness through the literature we can provide and the people we can provide with the help of whom. So we want to take help to every doorstep. Now if you have that vision and you're bringing about that little perspective in the world, you're being responsible. But you say, I want to change the world. The world is not a good place. But what do you want to change? You want to change people, you want to change some particular attitude of the people, you want to change the way another person is feeling, you want to change the economic condition. So we need to be very, very responsible when we are making any action. I'm thinking I want to save the world. I'm thinking I want to destroy the world. No damage done to the world. In my head, I'm playing one drama. It's absolutely okay. At days, I'm the hero. So I'm permitting myself an emotional drama of that nature. At days, I'm the villain and I'm beating up people and I am enjoying that drama at my level. But as soon as you take an action, it has a bigger impact. And that is why responsibility becomes an extremely vital scope that we need to develop as a habit. Right? Now, how do we learn to take responsibility? That brings me to the next thing, which is more attitude rather than a habit. What brings responsibility is culture. Every family, every community, every society, every school teaches a particular kind of culture to their children. Okay. Now, if we take very small examples, example from the education space, a family where you have more people who have done science and there is one creative child in that family, a lot of times it becomes very complex for that child to be able to hold in the culture of that family, because they would say, tu kya history padhta rehta hai, ya tu kya literature padhta rehta hai, all of this will not fetch you marks, why don't you do science? I mean, I'm not saying all parents are like that. I'm just saying the culture in the house ends up becoming a particular kind because of the kind of books we read, because of the kind of people we meet, because of the kind of society we come from, because of the kind of festivals we celebrate, because of the kind of professions we come from. Ab kuch bhi ho, a doctor ka soch and a counselor ka soch can end up being very, very, very different. So both of us come from the mental health world. But a doctor would say these are the symptoms and these are the medications, so I need to be part of the solution in the person's life. A counselor can only say, I will be the catalyst in your life, I will hold your hand, you will find your own solutions. So we are both from the same profession, but yet our personalities can end up being very different because we come from different professions. So everything in our life is influenced by culture, and then what we do becomes my own culture. So the next attitude to have is to recognize what is your culture. It's a very easy way to recognize what your culture is. Come back and write 5 things you learned from your father, 5 things you learned from your mother, 5 things you disliked about the way your family worked, 5 things you like about the way your family worked. Okay. The books you read, the heroes you end up identifying with, or the villains you end up identifying with, doesn't matter. Life finally works in the grey shades. Okay. So whom do you identify with? Kiska emotion aapke dil ko chhuta hai aur bolta hai, oh my god, I identify with this person. I'll take a small filmy example for that. In Tare Zameen Par, when the movie had released, a lot of people could identify with the emotion of the younger child who was going through the obvious thing of not being understood. He had dyslexia. Nobody in his environment knew that he had dyslexia, and that was creating him to be misunderstood to a level that his self-esteem was taking a beating every minute. Jab tak wo lad sakta tha, bindas, I will do whatever I feel like doing, he was doing it, but then he was systematically getting broken because he was not fitting into the culture of that particular family. But the person I felt sadder for in that particular film was the elder brother. Okay. Trying that very hard to cope up to expectations, pushing himself and doing very well, and he found his childhood only in the brother. He could laugh, he could smile, he could just be, you know, in awe saying, oh, you could do such a big jigsaw puzzle yourself, and not himself attempt anything beside what is expected out of him. And the time his brother goes off to the hostel, the brother begins to have a breakdown. He begins to lose his tennis matches. He begins to not be. So, wo apna bachpan apne bhai ke through jee raha tha. Right? Now, if you see bahar se, it was an absolutely normal, functional, happy family. Papa thoda sa chidate hai, mummy bahut pyar karti hai, everybody is trying to do their best. But if you go to see the struggle that both the children are going through in that particular thing, everybody will be able to see the younger one's struggle, the older one's struggle becomes slightly complicated to pick because there's nothing wrong with the boy. But the fact that he doesn't feel like a child, he's only living up to expectations, it will take a slight keen eye to see ki bacche ke saath ye nahi karna chahiye. Right? So, ये चीजें define the culture in our life. कि आप बच्चे से expect क्या करते हैं. Now, I'm not saying you should have zero expectations. You will expect the child to go to school, no? You cannot say we are non-expecting parents, तुमको जो करना है करो. तो फिर तो वो पूरा दिन internet पे बैठे रहेंगे. But defining the culture of that particular thing, the school's parents send their children to. There are some schools all of us know are very competitive in nature. Okay. They are there to churn out whatever, the top 10%. And they themselves throw out people who cannot work on that particular level. But there are schools which say we work with overall development. Some child might be great in math, some child might be great in cricket. So who's great in cricket, we work with him in cricket and tell him ki kam se kam itna tumko science mein aana chahiye, and who's great at science will push him and say ek dance performance mein part le lo na beta. Right? So the culture that I am creating around my world is an emotional attitude that we work with. And if you go to see today what is causing the maximum amount of stress is the culture that we are confused with. I am not pro or against a particular culture saying hum sab westernized ho rahe hain kya, Indian culture bhul rahe hain kya, vagaira vagaira. Are we able to assimilate the strengths of all the cultures which are part of our life? Yeah, we are getting caught in the conflict of cultures in that particular level. Okay. So, there are certain families, I'm okay with my children wearing jeans, but I am not okay with my daughter telling me that she has a boyfriend. I mean, you gave her the freedom, no? I mean, jeans does not equal to freedom. I love wearing saris. But jeans, and on the other hand, a sense of suppression saying, humne tumko uska itna freedom diya, iska galat fayda nahi uthana. A lot of parents end up saying that. Galat fayda matlab kya? Parents also don't know, they don't have definitions. Children to surely don't know. So having friends, is that galat fayda uthana? Having a boyfriend or a girlfriend, is that galat fayda uthana? Having drugs, is that galat fayda uthana? So freedom ka galat fayda nahi uthana, there it needs to be defined in boundaries, and that is what makes culture. Culture is not loose. Culture is very well defined. You take up a dance item. It is not chaotic on stage there. If there is chaos, it is deliberate chaos. It is part of the choreography. It is not that you go and do anything on the stage and it is going to be called dance. So take up anything in culture. a story from literature. Will you have anything in a story which is not meant to be there? It is tied in beautifully together. Take a simple story, okay? Marriages is equal to happily ever after. You take any story. Aap Ram Sita lelo, Cinderella lelo, jo bhi. Shadi ho gai matlab happily ever after. But a lot of us do not remember that there is 2.5 hours which happened before that. You went through your struggles. You looked at your villains. You fought. The hero climbed mountains, went through fire, met some wise old man somewhere who told him the direction on how to reach that Rakshas. Then you went and killed the Rakshas. There is so much that happened before the happily ever after. A lot of us are so lost and confused about it. We get married and then we say, no, we are not compatible. Why are you not compatible? Oh no, we have a fight for everything. Arey, but why are you having a fight? Sit down, figure out. Aapki personality differences jo hain. It's not about adjustment or compromising. Find the meeting point, no? You want to go for a drive. Your spouse doesn't like driving. Okay, they like to sit down and watch a movie and then talk about that movie. So few times go for the drive, few times watch that movie and discuss. No, we are not compatible. Okay. Now this lack of compatibility is lack of culture. Lack of saying, kahaniyon mein ek sequence hota hai. A lack of being able to follow a sequence. You want it sorted, or you come back and judge it saying it's not sorted. We don't see that everything has an order and it needs to be sorted. A story does not start and end with shadi ho gai happily ever after. It starts with two personalities, how they come together, how there are differences, how they fight their villains, then how they reach a happily ever after. So, problem solving, being able to change yourself, being able to accommodate and learn to live in a bigger family, being able to be successful in careers, requires culture. It requires science. I'm not taking away from science. Science helps us think in a particular way, but to create the steps is brought in by culture. And culture is defined by the smallest things. Aap khana kya khate hain, aap kapde kya pehante hain, aap ek dusre se baat kis tone mein karte hain, right? So, not being racist or anything about it, I'm just taking a characteristic. If you see Punjabis and Gujaratis, they speak a little loudly. It is not because they are louder people or whatever, it's just that they are a little bit in the josh. The garba and the bhangra and the khakra and the fafra and the parathas just makes them very peppy as people. Okay. On the other hand, if you will end up seeing a South Indian family where you do the Bharatnatyams and you do, the discipline is a lot more higher. Okay, so this is again not a comparison saying which one is better or which one is worse. But there is a culture which will define the tone in which I'll talk. Now one person from a Punjabi family getting married into a family which is very quiet does not mean this person has to kill their tendencies. They have to soften, they have to accept. You can't call this incompatibility and say things don't work. So, culture, being able to assimilate the positives, being able to accept that my culture can also end up having negatives, letting go of the negatives. I use bigger examples only to make a point, but choti choti cheezon mein wo hota hai. The sati system had to go. It wasn't healthy. It happened at that point of time because the number of men who died at war would leave women vulnerable in a chaotic world. Today, we have women who are educated, who are healthy, who can manage themselves, and the world, I feel, has become much safer than what it was maybe 100 years back. Nobody was getting killed or nobody went for wars that much, the frequency with which wars and all happened. So given this whole thing, the sati system had to go because that was a sociological need at that point of time. But has marriage gone out of culture? आप इंडिया की बात कर लो, आप अब्रॉड की बात कर लो, आप हम लोग यूजुअली बोलते हैं वेस्ट में रिलेशनशिप्स को इम्पोर्टेंस नहीं है. आई डोंट थिंक सो. इफ यू वॉच एनी ऑफ देयर फिल्म्स और एनी थिंग, इफ दे आर प्रपोजिंग फॉर मैरिज, दैट मीन्स इट इज समथिंग दे वॉन्ट टू डू फॉर लाइफ. तो अमेरिका में मैरिजेज इज अबाउट टुडे मैरिज टुमारो डिवोर्स, ऐसा नहीं होता है. द इंटेंशन इज स्टिल दैट यू वॉन्ट टू लिव अ होल मैरिज. सो मैरिज एज एन इंस्टीट्यूशन सर्वाइव्ड बिकॉज इट इज पार्ट ऑफ आर पॉजिटिव कल्चर. ओके, सो कल्चर एंड डिफिनेशंस ऑफ हाउ वी वर्क विद कल्चर, द फेस्टिवल्स दैट वी एंड अप सेलिब्रेटिंग डिफाइन हु वी आर. Another simple example, being a Hindu, I'll be able to take Hindu example, but I am sure there are enough examples in every culture about it. Dashera. Dashera is not about making those sweets and doing one loud celebration. It's about killing the villains. It's about letting go the villains. The Ravan, the Meghdoot and the Kumbhakaran are burned on that day. So it is called Vijayadashmi. The day I can say I have conquered my villains, then I am somebody who is eligible to celebrate Dashera. It is not about buying those sweets and saying, ah, it is Dashera. So every religion for any festival has a story attached to it. Culture is not about doing the rituals of that particular story. A lot of times religion can end up becoming that. But culture is about recognizing the build-up that has led to that particular celebration. To know what all it took to be able to reach that celebration. So there is no celebration which has a very only positive story behind it. Holi mein, there is somebody trying to kill a child and the child survives. So you celebrate the Holika Dehan and all that. So if we go into stories, I can pick up thousands of stories to talk about it. But culture is in our stories, in our art, in our way of it shapes our thinking, and that's how it will reflect in our feeling. So very healthy emotional attitude is living in culture. Okay. Now living in culture brings me to the next step. It teaches us acceptance. Okay. Now acceptance is a slightly complicated term. कोई किसी को मार रहा है, अरे just accept, ये तो दुनिया में होता रहता है. Somebody is suppressing you, अरे you have to accept and adjust, you have to get suppressed. You are doing anything, you expect the other person to accept. I mean, suppose I'm a depressed person and I cry. And I cry, 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 and I say my husband should keep accepting my crying. I mean, that's a little unfair. So acceptance does not mean that you have to tolerate the other person. This tricky distance between tolerance and acceptance, we will need to understand that part of it. A Hindu wants to pray in a particular way, a Muslim wants to pray in a particular way, a Christian wants to pray in a particular way, that is acceptance. But if somebody is beating somebody, I'm being accepting, that is not acceptance, that is tolerance. Okay, so given all of these things, acceptance simply means that ye situation hai, not denying and saying ki nahi hamare desh mein to sab theek hai, there is no problem at all and we are all very sorted. No, coming back and saying, yes, we are dealing with suppression of certain sections of the society even now. Being in Bombay, I cannot and I shouldn't and I don't talk about being a suppressed woman. I've been brought up, as I said, in a liberal environment, given all the opportunities that my brother got and feel very successful about myself. But does not mean that 200 kilometers from here, there is no village where women don't feel that way. I don't have to deny the problems, but you have to say, yes, my culture, my society also has these problems. Ab isme you can choose what is the problem you will want to be part of the solution of and not put your head into every problem. Have an opinion about every problem, but do nothing about any problem. So acceptance ka matlab hota hai, be able to be solution oriented in the areas you can and let the others be taken care of by others and not have an opinion about everything and anything. So accept life as it is and choose your journey. A lot of us call it our calling, a lot of us call it our destiny, a lot of us call it different things of that. But choose the change you want to be part of, rather than having an opinion about every ill in the society. That is called acceptance. So acceptance then brings me to honesty. We'll have to be honest to accept. There are problems, I'll have to accept that. But a lot of us mix up honesty with rudeness. Main to bindaas bol deti hun jo mujhe bolna hota hai. Trust me, that's not being honest. That's being blunt. Okay, that's being reactive. Being honest means you recognize what about that will you take responsibility of and reflect back, not react back. तो कई बार होता है हम लोग ये चीजें करते हैं. Somebody is saying something, you don't agree with that opinion, you just put your head down, you smile, you let it go. Yeah, you have a lot of saying, दो कान किस लिए दिए हैं, एक कान से सुनने का, एक कान से निकाल देने का. That you will not let it have an impact on yourself. So honesty does not mean that you need to have one honest opinion about everything. You need to know what you will be part of and what you will not be part of. You need to know how much of the situation is your problem and how much of the situation is the other person's problem, so you will both come together and solve it. There are places where I need to apologize. There are places where I feel that I don't think maine itna kuch galat kar diya, par tumhe itna kyun bura lag raha hai? Maybe you can run me through it, or maybe I'm sorry you felt hurt, but that is not the intention I was coming from. That is honesty that we are talking about. So saying you are like your mother because you are whatever, your mother has a hold on you, that's not being honest. That's having an opinion. So honesty is a truth that we live within ourselves, we agree on it, and we see the whole world in that light. And this is my personal feeling on it. Anybody who respects themselves will not be able to disrespect other people. So it is not how good you are is not defined by what others speak about you, but how you speak about the other people defines you, who you are as a person. So if you respect your mother, you will not go and disrespect somebody else's mother. If you respect your religion, you will not go and disrespect somebody else's religion. So if you are having a need to disrespect something outside, then I will need to first ask myself, what am I missing? Why am I feeling angry about that thing that that person is doing? Okay. We can become curious, we can become sad, we can become lost. Taking a recent example, there are 11 people of a family who chose to end themselves, right? I don't know what happened there. I can only be curious, saying, matlab, how can somebody be so influenced that common sense wala cheez that, boss, you got life, God is not saying come back to me. He's told you, go, live. Okay. So, how can that common sense not be there? It can confuse me, but I don't need to be opinionated or angry about that particular family saying, kaise bevkoof log hai? I don't know what they were thinking. I don't know what they were going through. I don't know what is the culture they were brought up in. I don't know how they looked at God. So, I don't know what happened there. So honesty simply means I don't know what they were thinking. Not ki wo log bevkoof log the, and they were thinking in a irrational manner. So honesty simply means permitting yourself to have empathy and not have opinions. That becomes honest. And lastly, to tie up all the emotional habits together, truth. And again, truth is a very funny word. Okay. Why is it funny? Because कब वो truth है और कब वो perspective है, कई बार वो थोड़ा गड़बड़ हमारा हो जाता है. So we'll take a very small example on that one. Suppose a husband and wife are having a fight. 5 साल पहले दोनों का कोई बहुत जबरदस्त झगड़ा हुआ. 20 मिनट्स दे स्क्रीम्ड एट ईच अदर. देन द हस्बैंड वेंट टू ऑफिस, द वाइफ वेंट टू हर ऑफिस और किचन और वॉट एवर दैट शी इज डूइंग. हैज द फाइट एंडेड? नो, द फाइट इज स्टिल गोइंग ऑन इन देयर हेड्स. When he is in the car, when he is traveling, the husband is still thinking, मैं उसको ये भी बोलूंगा, मैं उसको वो भी बोलूंगा, फिर वो ऐसा बोलेगी, फिर मैं ऐसा बोलूंगा. The wife is also thinking when she is doing her work on ये ऐसा, वो वैसा, वो वैसा, वो ऐसा. Now 5 years later, when you sit to discuss that incident, memory plays the villain. You don't know कि सचमुच में तुमने एक दूसरे को क्या बोला था एंड बाद में अपने अपने दिमाग में एक दूसरे को क्या बोला था. सो द हस्बैंड विल एंड अप सेइंग, मैंने तो ऐसा बोला ही नहीं था. एंड द वाइफ विल फाइट सेइंग, तुमको याद नहीं रहता है, तुमने तो ऐसा बोला ही था. और वाइस वर्सा, ओके, द वाइफ विल एंड अप सेइंग, तुम तो पता नहीं किधर किधर से समझते रहते हो, मैंने ये कब बोला तुमको, मुझे याद है, अच्छी तरह से याद है, तुमने ये बोला था. नाउ हियर हुम विल यू साइड विद एंड से हूज ट्रू? नहीं, आप 10 जन से पूछ लो, इसका पर्सनालिटी ऐसा है, इसने ऐसा बोला ही होगा. सो आई एम कन्विंसिंग माई सेल्फ दैट वॉट आई एम सेइंग इज ट्रू, वेयर इज आई एम नॉट श्योर हाउ मच ऑफ इट इज माई मेमोरी एंड हाउ मच ऑफ इट इज द एक्चुअल थिंग दैट एंडेड अप हैपनिंग. बिकॉज मेमोरी के अंदर जो स्टोरेज है, इट विल नॉट ऑलवेज बी सो वेल डिफाइंड. So a lot of times when we hang on to truths, we need to be flexible to come back and say, my memory or my perception or my attitude could be failing. Another example to take up on the true or the untrue, considering fights bahut kaun right hai aur kaun wrong hai par lekar hoti hai. Okay. I've worked with a lot of couples jahan suppose the wife is brought up in Bombay and the husband is brought up in a smaller town, and now he is in Bombay and they are married and working a life. Now for the woman, having a drink once in a while with friends, so it's not like she is an alcoholic and sitting and drinking every day, once in 6 months uske college ke koi friends gather hue and she had 2 drinks is okay. But for the husband, main bhi nahi peeta, ये औरतों के पीती है, isn't she wrong? Now their counselors get into a bind, we can't say who's right, who's wrong. There are just differences there. You can't say this is the truth that people should not drink. There are people and enough people who drink. So is the truth that drinking should not be done a culture? It is your family culture. You can't make it a universal family culture. So truth can have dimensions, and only if we understand those dimensions will we be able to do all the other things that I talked about. If we don't hold on to truth with rigidity, we become flexible, and if we become flexible, the rest begins to fall in. So introspection, containment, empathy, honesty, all of these are very few things for us to develop in ourselves, and to develop we need the culture to help us develop. Okay, isliye hum ghar ke mahol ki ya society ke mahol ki bahut baat karte hain, because you want to give the best culture, and culture doesn't define right and wrong. Culture will talk about heroes also, villains also, in the same manner. The book will not say I will not talk about villains. So you introduce children to the gray shades also, you introduce culture of the right things also, and you value all of those things, and that makes us, yeah. So thank you very much.
Thank you.